Hey guys, just a few quick announcements for you. We have a unique opportunity to serve our community with a truckload of fresh produce and dairy, 1,200 boxes that we will be passing out. If you or someone you know would benefit from this, save the date of Saturday, April 10th. We also need volunteers to help direct traffic and load the boxes into the cars that day. Sign up at the Connection Center or on the Serve page. Builders for Christ has two missions trips coming up this summer. We're hosting the first informational meeting on Sunday, April 11th at 6 p.m. Sign up at the Connection Center or on the app and website. Easter is coming, you guys. This year, we have 4 Sunday services in person, and of course, we're also live streaming. If this works better for your family, watch the service live on Roku, or you can stream us on our Jacobsville app. For Good Friday, April 2nd, we have 2 services, 5 p.m. and 7 p.m., with no JW kids. For Easter, Sunday, April 4th, we have 4 services, 7:30 with no JW kids, and then 9 a.m., 11 a.m., and 1:30 p.m. with JW kids. To make our services for Easter and Good Friday the best they can be, we need your help. We believe that more people will be checking us out, and honestly, checking out church for the first time in a while, especially at our 9 and 11 a.m. services. We are ready for our volunteers to come back, and for new volunteers to join in and help us. We will need greeters, ushers, people to serve coffee, help with parking, and so much more. Consider attending one service and serving at another. Maybe attend the early 7:30 or afternoon 1:30 p.m. and then serve at the 9 and 11. We have many options, so visit the Serve page to get plugged in. This year, because we have limited capacity, we are asking that you RSVP for Good Friday and Easter Sunday. This isn't to reserve specific seats, it's just so we know which service you'll be attending so we can anticipate and have enough space for everyone. You can RSVP on the app or the Easter page. Okay, I know that was a lot. To double check the info, just jump on the Jacobswell app or our website. Now, let's breathe and get ready for worship. Well, good morning, Jacobswell. Good morning to everybody watching online. We are excited that you're here with us this morning. Let's stand and get ready for worship. One of the things I've been thinking about lately is when we're here together and we're worshiping and we're singing and we're dancing, whatever it is you do, it's just a glimpse of what we get to do in heaven someday. And that just brings me a lot of joy. So this morning, when we're dancing and singing, I don't want to be the only singing up here, okay? I don't want to be the only one dancing up here. I want to see some movement. I want to see some smiles this morning, all right? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are thankful for your presence this morning. Lord, I pray that you would draw near to us as we worship. Lord, I pray that you would just bring joy this morning. Bring us a smile. Let us just dance in the freedom that you give us, Lord. We are thankful and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys know this one, okay? I know you know.
treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in thank you. find me now, where the grace runs as deep as your scars. You pull me from the clay, set me on a rock, call me by your name, made my heart whole again, lift it up.
Jesus, we all are broken. There are pieces of our life, Lord, that are messy, that we might be ashamed of, Lord, but in you, we have grace. Jesus, you love us regardless of the messy, of the hard, of the broken. Lord, you call us your own. You'll hold us and draw us near to you, Lord. We worship you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys can take a seat.
it's the worst part of my life. Loneliness. That's a quote from a young woman who wrote an article for the Boston Globe about loneliness, about this thing that is part of so many people's lives. In the article, she quoted a study that said, loneliness is physically impairing. In fact, deep loneliness can be more harmful to you physically than 15 years of smoking. The title of the article was, let me make sure I get this right, "The Biggest Threat to Middle-Aged Men is Not Obesity, It's Loneliness." It, in the article, said that 2 in 5 people say they have no meaningful relationships. 70% of men say they have no close friends. Loneliness. It's a powerful force. It's this tendency we have to isolate. And this has been like the year that isolation has been like an Olympic sport, right? By the way, how good does it feel to just be re-engaging in worship? I mean, if you're, yeah, it just feels amazing. And that's true whether you're doing the work online and part of the virtual church who listens from all over the country and all over the world, or whether you're here in person. It just feels so good to make that effort to connect with other people. Because loneliness is just this debilitating thing. We've been isolated and lonely because of COVID, right? It's just been easy. And I hope you realize we've come a long way. At this time last year, we were washing our groceries as we were taking them home from the grocery store. Remember? And we've done a lot of things, and we can all look back and say, oh, we overdid it, or we didn't do it, or whatever. And we're almost there, gang. Here, before too long, I just believe we're going to be ripping these masks up. We're going to have a mask-burning party, I think. I'm just ready. I get it. We're not there quite yet, all right? So let's all behave, all right? But the thing is, it just feels good to reconnect, to see faces, to, I can't wait to hug everybody. Y'all better watch out. I'm going to be a hugging machine when we are able to hug again. And we've been COVIDing, right? There's been political tensions. There's been social tensions where we're not sure what we can say to who and people we thought before. We were on the same page, not where. And so now, you know, it's just easier. I'm just going to go home and just watch my version of the news and get more certain. And that's isolated us. Some people isolate because of shame. You may be the kind of person who, whenever someone gets close, you do something to sabotage that relationship because deep down you have this part of you that's afraid if people really saw you, they'd know you and that'd be terrible. And the shame narrative makes you isolate. Others, it's a fear of failure. Maybe you've tried and not gone well. Maybe you've been hurt. Maybe you've gone through a divorce or separation or a friend or betrayal or just something that you've kind of convinced yourself it's easier to be alone. It's easier to just, you know, find Netflix or gaming or just something. But here's the deal. You cannot be a fully formed person. You cannot be a mature person. You cannot be a spiritual person if you are an isolated person. And I understand some of you may say, I'm just an introvert. I get it. An introvert who's really self-aware and mature understands this. That it's not that I don't need relationships. It's the volume of relationships, the quality of relationships. So even if you're an introvert, all of us need people. That's one of the cool things that you may not have ever noticed about the vision statement around here. It says, wherever I am, does it say I? No, it says wherever we are. Notice all the we's and the r's and the plural inclusives. We did that by design because life change happens best, most powerfully, most thoroughly within community. We make progress better when we are we. That's what's so tragic about the world trying to tear us apart and rip us apart, that we're so convinced that it's important that people know what we think and our positions and what we stand for and what is our position, that we've totally lost our posture, which should be love. And on the altar of our opinions, we have sacrificed that which is most precious, that which is actually eternal, our relationships. Okay? And so notice the we's. Wherever we are on our journey, we will take steps together to know and become like Jesus. And so I need you to help me become like Jesus. I need you to help me live in the love relationship with Jesus. You need me to help you, and we need each other to become everything God intended us to be. That's one of the powerful things about our journey tool. We've been looking at this throughout the renewal process and this journey we've been on as a church. And we're just talking about that life change happens when the Holy Spirit stirs up thirst, and we find the courage to search and ask deep questions. And then the God of Revelation shows us steps we're supposed to take within the context of his love relationship. And in that, we start integrating into our life. And that's when the work begins. Where we have to choose the narrow road where it starts hard but leads to life instead of the wide road where lots of people are on it. Isn't it interesting though that the wide road with all the people on it, they're all lonely? Pursuing your own thing will make you lonely. Okay? And so wide road, but that one leads to death. Experience is where we choose to do some hard things, some difficult things, where we start learning the power of a long obedience in the same direction. That leads to depth. Depth is when the things we long to do happen in our life because what's changed is what's changed inside of us. We start being transformed to be a good person from whom good things naturally flow. We start storing up good things in our storehouse. And a big part of that is storing up good relationships and learning how to do good relationships and putting in the work and making the sacrifice so that we can become a fully formed person, a person who thinks, feels, and acts like Jesus, okay? That's what depth is. Now, you've noticed, perhaps, that through this is we've got these two strands holding this all together. One, of course, is the Holy Spirit, who is always at work. We've been saying from the beginning, he's passionately committed to your formation. He is working on you even when you're not working. He's got a plan to make you like Jesus. Part of his plan is the other ring, the other band that holds us together, like true tracks on a train track, keeping the train moving forward, is this thing of human community. Because sometimes we just need someone with skin, right? Sometimes we just need someone to walk alongside that. And one of the greatest adventures of life, this will help you find meaning in life, is how to be a relationally mature person. How to grow in things like self-awareness, how to grow in things like humility, how to grow in things like service, how to become an incredible listener, how to rather focus not so much on your accomplishments, but helping other people to accomplish, rather than becoming very concerned with people being interested in you and knowing your opinion, but to be incredibly curious about people. All of these things makes you a relationally powerful, healthy, whole person. And when you get more and more of that, it establishes community. Now, I understand. I make it sound beautiful, and it's hard, okay? There are times when we're not good people, and the people we're not are not good people. And so we got to learn things like patience and kindness and gentleness and forbearance and long-suffering, okay? We got to learn things like forgiveness. And when we start learning those things, it not only transforms the community and brings healing to the people we're interacting with, it does something inside of us. It makes us the people we long to be. Good people from whom good things naturally flow. And the greatest, listen now. The greatest indication that that is taking place is not how much Bible you know, is not how often you come to church, is not how much money you give to good things. It's not, you know, any of those things. The greatest indication that's really how that's taking place is how you treat people, particularly the least of these. And by the least of these, I think that means people who really can't add too much to you materially or in this world, people who you could give yourself permission to dismiss or disregard. And sometimes that's a person far away or a person who's in a different situation than you, but sometimes it's the person you live with. And so the greatest indication that you are truly in Christ, a Christian, mature, being discipled, is how you treat people. So this thing of community demands a serious Christian to say, okay, this is worth me shaking off the dust, rejecting the brokenness, even I would say the sin of isolation, and instead say, you know, I want to fill my life with good people because I want to be a good person. So this thing of community is everything. So the verse we're looking at this week in the Renew series is one you've maybe heard before, but let me just put it in context right now. All right, this is a verse from the book of Hebrews. Book of Hebrews has several important themes, but perhaps the central theme of the book of Hebrews is there is a danger of falling away from your faith. There are seven major passages in the book of Hebrews that are warnings, really an instruction manual on how to walk away from faith. And this verse sets up the context for one of those passages. And so to say it this way, one of the first steps of seeing God drift out of your life is letting community drift out of your life. Okay? This is not just a good idea to improve your life. This is crucial to your relationship with God. So just let me say it another way. You can't be right with God and not be right with people. They are two sides of the same coin. That's why Jesus summed up everything he said about how we should live, about the law and everything that's important. He said basically it's two things, love God and love people. And you know what he said about that? He said the first commandment is the greatest, love God. He said the second is like unto it. That is to say, it really is the same thing. So if you say you love God, another author in the Bible says, you say you love God, but you hate your brother, you are a liar and the truth is not in you. That's what the Bible says. And so this thing of community is not something that you can give yourself permission to just disregard, to say, I don't need, that it's not worth the effort. It's central to who we are as followers of Jesus Christ. It starts off with mindset. Let us consider. Let's think about this. Let's take a hard look at this. Let's look at the excuses we use. I'm too busy. No one understands. It's not worth it. I'm tired. I work too hard. You know, all the different excuses. Let us consider, what would it look like if my life were more relational? What would if I put the priority? By the way, it's wonderfully practical. You know, teachers understand that what drives teaching is relationship. Good business leaders understand that the most important thing they do has to do with relationships within customers and employees and all that other kind of stuff like that. It's everything. He said, let us consider. Think about the power of relationships. Think about the meaning of relationships. Meaning in this life is not found in accumulating stuff. It's not getting more and more stuff. One of my favorite authors says that in the first part of life, we build this container, which is how we live and the job we have and the stuff we have. He said, but when we really get wise in the second half of life, the second half of life is filling that container with meaningful things, things that actually matter. And at the heart of that is relationships and how we treat people. And so it is worth redeeming them and fighting for them and reigniting them and pushing for them. He says, let us consider how we might stir one another up. Now, some of you say, oh, I stir people up. It's not about Facebook posts. It's not being the person who enjoys poking at people. Some of you, you like poking at people and teasing people. It's actually a fun thing about you and people enjoy it, but it's actually also a way you keep people from getting too close. I do this. You know, whenever I'm in a group and people have figured me out and they're starting to ask me questions that are bothering me, I start making jokes. I was in a meeting once, actually a board meeting, an overseer meeting at this church, and they were asking me about something I really didn't want to talk about. They do that. You really have a good board. They annoy me sometimes, but they're such a good board. And I was joking about on this, and he just looked at me stone-faced. Everybody else was laughing. He said, Paul, do you know that you do that? I said, when it gets too close to home, you just make a joke. It's just hard to make a joke after that. I'll tell you, it's really hard to make a joke after that. But I was exposed, and it was this wonderful brother stirring up in me, trying to bring the best in me. So you're not trying to stir up frustration. You're not trying to stir up annoyance. You're not trying to show that you're the smartest guy in the room or the most articulate or you can turn a phrase. No, you're trying to stir up good things. You're trying to get some things going. You're asking questions that maybe are provocative and helpful to say, well, what if you did this? Or what if you did this? Or you're trying to find words of encouragement that is going to give a person life. You're trying to shift a perspective. You're just going into listening mode so this person can just vomit all the crazy stuff that's in your head. Have you ever needed to do that? Just get with a friend and say, I'm going to say everything I think. I know all of it's wrong and just terrible. Blah, blah, blah. And the person goes, yeah, I felt like that. And they don't try to fix anything. I mean, that's stirring up. And let us consider, let us think about, let us train ourselves, let us learn how to do relationships well so that we can stir one another up. Look at this, towards love, because that's the big call. And you're going to hear that a lot from me in the next probably year, 6 months, because it's just burning in my heart. Because Christians right now think the important thing is that everybody knows our position and that we're clear, okay? The world doesn't care about our position. What they need to see is our posture, which is love. And so they need to see service, and they see grace, they need to see listening, they see tolerance, they need to see understanding. And so we're supposed to stir each other towards love. Love is service. Love is that person becoming the best version of themselves. When you are a person who truly is loving in a non-toxic and wonderful, non-manipulative, glorious, beautiful way, you're awesome. You're who you want to be. God's desire becomes your desire. So we stir each other to love. And look at this, in good works. To do good things, to strive for the good things they want in their life. So we learn the power of being positive in people's life, a positive force for good. This is why it's so important for us to be growing as Christians, so that we, one, don't need to be forever leaning on someone else, but we can actually stand on our own, and then others can lean on us. And so he says, let us consider, let's work it out, how we can do this. Let's get good at this. And then he says this next verse that we've read so many times, it's so powerful, not neglecting the meeting together as is the habit of some. Isn't that a powerful verse? He said, let's not just, you know, say, too busy, too hard. You know what? I'm just that person, the one guy in the group, you know, whatever it is, whatever excuse you've given to yourself, don't neglect it. Okay? Don't let it, you know, fall by the wayside. It's too important to neglect. So to get this, as some have fallen into the habit. Now, wow, is there a verse for COVID season? And I get it, we had to do what we had to do, and none of us knew what was going on, and we're all still getting through it the best we can. But man, we have fallen into some habits, some patterns. And it's making it hard for some of us to come back to God, some of us to come back to church, some of us to come back to healthy relationships, because some habits that need to be considered and addressed and changed, and sometimes that'll be uncomfortable because we've learned to cope on some of these bad habits. But we fall into some bad habits. He says, don't neglect. Because what it leads to is you think maybe I'm just getting isolated from people, but if you're honest with yourself, you're getting isolated from God. You're getting isolated from good things, and you may be filling your heart and mind with things on the TV and the internet and all that, just hardening you. He says, let's not do that. He goes on. He says, but encourage one another. Be encouraging. Don't we just need more people who are encouraging? I mean, we have just had a year of people telling us, be afraid, be afraid, be afraid. Be angry, be angry, be angry. We've been swimming in it, and it's toxic. And then hate, hate, hate. You don't understand. When people disagree with you, they're evil. They're not just disagreeing. They're evil. You don't have to listen to them. You don't have to care. You can do unethical things in terms of what you say and how you treat them because they're evil, okay? You understand they're evil? And you know what? You sure don't have to love them. And you sure don't have to serve him. And we've been swimming in this. What a breath of fresh air. What a ray of sunshine is someone who speaks hope and comfort and encouragement. Who says, you know what? We got God and the story ends really good. And it's a powerful thing. Encourage one another all the more as the day is drawing near. The day of Christ's return. The day of healing. The day of restoration. I mean, if anybody should be full of life and hope, it is Christians who believe in the resurrection and who believe in the return of Christ. Because that changed everything. We're about to have Easter next week. This weekend is the weekend that church calls Palm Sunday, where we celebrate Jesus coming into Jerusalem and we remember all the things. Some of you are saying, wow, is that this week? That's this week. And remember his passion and his cross and laying in the tomb and all those stories about him appearing to people. And this is the center to our faith, this incredible historical event, overwhelming evidence for the historical resurrection of Jesus Christ. This is our hope. And just take a step back in context of what we're talking about today. Why did Jesus do that? For relationship. For relationship. To have a love relationship with you and to so transform you that you could have a love relationship with him through the Spirit to the Father, so that you would be so transformed that you can reach out to brothers and sisters and find courage and strength and healing and forgiveness, so that you can reach out to a world that desperately needs hope and says there's Jesus. That's what the cross is. It's about this relationship with the Father and the relationship with each other. And Jesus said, that's why when he brought us communion, he said, this is the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. The word covenant literally means, literally, but it theologically means a spiritual committed relationship. And so he came to renew, to heal, and to bring relationship. If that's how it's important to him, man, it should be that important to us. And we should understand it as the center of our relationship. Now, one of the things we've been doing throughout this season, and we're going to keep doing, is we're going to tell some stories because we turned 20, and we're just going to indulge in some celebration. I just think celebration is a form of worship. It's a spiritual discipline. And we're going to tell the story about a group of people who have been meeting in community and group for like 17, 18 years. And this is their story of their group. And let's just go ahead and take a look and just listen to the journey they've been on and the depth of relationship they've earned because of their willingness to make every effort and consider and be in relationship and community. Let's take a look.
This group has been meeting about 17 years, just about as old as our youngest.
So a really good dinner and really bad teaching is kind of the... No, but we meet and we do like 45 minutes of potluck that takes an hour. And then we do some study. I go out of a book or we go out of the Right Now Media. And then we have a prayer after the study and we go around the room and say, what's going on in the families? And I think that's been a pretty important part of what we do.
Well, the kitchen is important. I have an apron that says life happens in the kitchen. That's where the talking happens, the getting to know each other, the going deeper.
But the whole dynamics of the group has changed tremendously because we all had kids. You know, when you had, I don't know how many kids we had years ago, but it got pretty
30.
Wild. Yeah, it got pretty wild.
And one of the things that our kids have benefited from is when they get in trouble. There have been times where I've not been able to talk to my kids about stuff they can talk to other parents about. And so it's helpful to know that because you do life with those people, you know the likely answers that other dad is going to give my son or that other mom would give our daughter.
We have been together for a long time. We talked about how we had like our own pregnancies and then toddler and high school graduation and yeah. College graduation and marriages and grandbabies being born, and he had hip surgery. Two hip surgery. I'm like, we really run the gamut through life together. When we went through a tough time this fall, and I can't imagine having gone through it without having built those bridges to like carry us over.
I think we've all been through many hard times. I think now we're at the point of lots of us are losing parents or have lost parents. We've had crises with our kids over the years.
We have a couples group here. I'm the only single in this couples group. When I joined 11 or 12 years ago, I was married and I've since been divorced. The group has kept me on as part of the group, thankfully. But that's been one difficult time in my life. There's certainly been other times, and the support of this group has been invaluable. I mean, I'll probably start crying again now, but they've seen me cry. They've been there for me. This group has been a godsend for me, absolutely.
I think of our son when he fell and broke his back, you know, in 2012. Wow. And we're in the hospital and you guys are there right alongside us. You know, to me, that's what community is, you know. We're at the joyful weddings, but then we're at the crisis times too, and we've been there at funerals, and it's just the support that we have for one another.
Luckily, I think we laugh more than we cry.
That's what
I've
missed. That's what I've missed over this last year is just the laughter and just the kind of the silliness sometimes.
You know what the best thing about when we did that video and I was asking questions, one of the coolest things for me in terms of watching that, because I know all these folks, and I've kind of been on the side of that group, not been part of that group, but just know all those people, is they hadn't been able to get together, but through vaccinations and all kinds of stuff like that, they're getting back together, and it's just so incredible. As we were doing the interview, I had this sense that they were really beginning to realize how special what they had been part of it was. That it was like a holy moment where the Holy Spirit just set up and said, showed up and said, look what I did here. That you guys paid the price, you stuck with it, and there's other parts of the videos we couldn't show you where they talk about, you know, just having to, some weeks we didn't want to go, and at times it was just hard, but we stuck together and we did life, and now their relationships are such where they've done so much life together that it's this beautiful, holy thing in the tough times and the good times. And it's funny, you even hear him talk about very often the most important things, usually the most important thing, is not when we're sitting down and doing the Bible study, and that's important, we do all that, but more it's talking in the kitchen, or they didn't even talk about the stuff they do outside a group. But the point is this, is that that's what depth looks like. I mean, these are really awesome people, spiritually mature people who've walked together, and it's been a crucial part of their formation. Now, you may look at that and you may say, man, I have that. You may look at that and you say, you know what, I had that. Or you may say, boy, I want that. But and that's the point, isn't it? Is that let us consider how I may spur on to experience community in my life in ways that I never have before. Let me tell you about a couple next steps I want to really encourage you with. The first is just finish out the renewal guide. This has been an incredible journey. For some of you, I've heard from just so many of you are saying, boy, I had gotten out of the habit of spending time every day in the Word of God and prayer and thinking and studying, and it has been so renewing to do that. Even if you're just starting, man, jump on this week because it's going to talk deeply about community, give you some ideas about how you can start stepping back into community, because I get it's complicated, but man, it's worth the considering. And then I want to encourage you to get some self-initiated groups going on. Let me just be honest with you about just where we're at as a church. It's been a hard year to do groups, and right now we got some staff openings, and so we're struggling to get groups for everybody who wants groups, okay? But many of you have done group life for years, and so what you could do is you could send out to the group, say something funny like, hey, I bought a panel van, we're getting the band back together, ha ha ha, let's do group, something like that, okay? You can use that. Okay, but the point is it's worth it. And some of you say, I just don't know that I can start that. Well, then start with a campfire. Start with texting people who have been part of your life and call them in. You say, I don't really know if I have anybody. Well, think of someone else you know who you could just say, hey, could we get three or four people together? And if you're a person, I just don't like it, the group gets more than two or three, hey, that's fine. But the point is, start grouping up. Start reaching out. Get rid of some of the isolation. And maybe for you, it just looks like an afternoon at a coffee shop with a friend who you haven't got with for such a long time. You say, what in the world are we going to study? The thing about that is we got this thing called Right Now Media. And this thing Right Now Media has like literally 15,000 studies you could do. Okay, there's probably one or two that would meet a need. So just go on there and say, let's look through, let's do this. Let's do this book study, or let's do this study about work, or let's do this study about marriage, or let's do this study about finances, or something. And here's the thing, it'll be good, and maybe the study is going to be the thing that just invigorates you. But in group life, let me just say, the thing that actually, we're, in my experience, the Holy Spirit mostly shows up is the stuff around the study. The conversations, the meals you share, that when someone who forgets to be guarded starts talking about what's really in their heart or what's really going on in their with their kids, you know, in the kitchen. The kitchen is where a group happens. And so get the groups together. Now, I want to let you know what some other things coming up. Obviously, next week is Easter, April 4th. We have four services. Now, this is going to be a really important Easter. Do you realize we could not gather in person last year for Easter? We get to gather and celebrate the resurrection next week. Does that not sound great? I agree. That sounds great. So here's the thing about that. I suspect that more and more people are starting to put their head up and saying, boy, I need God. I need to get back to my church. And so Easter is going to be a Sunday where just a lot of people are going to be coming back. And so we need your help. If you're a regular person around here and you have found the hope of the resurrection, anybody here found the hope of the resurrection? Okay, amen. Me too. 9 and 11, unless you're bringing family or friends, if you've ever had a family and friends, come to 9 or 11, okay, if that's just, you know, getting people to come in, okay? But we want to open up some seats there for some folks who have not yet found the hope of the resurrection. You know, it may be the clinic we have hosted. I don't know if you realize this, but they're like at like 18,000 people have been vaccinated in our clinic. That's remarkable, okay? And people are walking and saying, I didn't even know this church was here. What's going on? How does this work? What? And we just think some of those folks might come, and they're going to be looking for the hope of the resurrection. So what we'd love is for you to come to the 7:30 or the 1:30. So say, oh, we do lunch. Well, this year do brunch. Do morning breakfast. Omelets are delicious, okay? Easter omelets, all right? And then come to afternoon. We ask you to RSVP, go online, okay? Just, you know, we're not being strict about you'll reserve a seat or anything like that, but what we're asking you to do is help us to make room for everybody to have the hope of the resurrection. And because this is going to be their step into Christ and their step into community, I want to let you know we're going to have two Good Friday services this Friday, and I think they're going to be just really healing times. The emotional and mental state of the general public, I would just use the word fragile right now. I would use the word fragile. Good Friday is going to be a healing time for us, and so we're going to do that. Well, I'll let you know something else. This could be something you could volunteer with. We just got this group that called us and said, hey, we'll send you 1,200 boxes of fresh fruits and vegetables and dairy, which are hard to get at food shelves, and all you have to do is give it away. So we're going to do that. So if you wanted to be part of this, if you know someone who could benefit from this, you can come pick up a box. If you need this, you can come use this. And if you want to volunteer for this, one of the best ways to get in community is often do some service project. And you want to talk about some of the people who have the best community in the church? It's the people who go to the Builders for Christ trips. And so maybe your group is a service group. And that's the opportunity that God is laying out before you this season. I want to encourage everybody, go ahead and grab your communion. If you're listening at home, I just want to say to you, if you prepared for communion, that's great. If you haven't, that's okay. Just spiritually have this with us. Because for us, what is really important is not the physical element of the bread. It's not the physical cup. We believe that the truly spiritual, supernatural thing that's important, the powerful thing, is happened 2,000 years ago when Jesus Christ died on the cross for you and he died on the cross for me. And that is what really matters here. And so we do this to remember that, to remember that God sent his only son that we on earth might have a relationship with him. And that because we have that relationship with him, we might love one another. And because we love one another, we might reach out to a world that desperately needs the hope of the resurrection. And that's what the cross is. And so when we have this, we remember many things. But this weekend, we are going to remember especially God's commitment to his relationship with us and his call for us to have relationships. So let me encourage you, open the top and take out the wafer. And the scriptures say, on the night before Jesus died, he said to his disciples, I have eagerly desired to share this with you. And I believe that Jesus continues to be eagerly desiring to share this with us. And he said, I'll be handed over to evil men who will put me to death. My body will be broken. And on the third day, I'll rise. And he held up the bread and he said, this is my body. He said, do this in remembrance of me. You can go ahead and open the lower container, the juice. And the Bible says that Jesus took the cup from the table, and he said about this cup is the cup of my blood. He said, this is the cup of the new and everlasting covenant. He said, when you take this, do this in remembrance of me. Let us pray together. Lord Jesus, Heavenly Father, Holy Spirit, God who is above us and mysterious, God who seems unknowable, you have stepped into our humanity, Jesus, so we could know you. We could know you and become like you. And when we're honest and when we can really listen to our hearts, that's what we really want. We want that to be powerful in changing us by the power of your Holy Spirit to be good people from whom good things naturally flow. And we know from your word that the greatest expression of that is how we treat people. And so, Holy Spirit, we ask you to search us and know us and try us and stir in us that we would consider how we could stir up others. Holy Spirit, I know you've spoken this week. There are those who are supposed to make a phone call. There are those who are supposed to make a text. There are those supposed to send an email to the group. There are those who are supposed to just forgive and try again. Holy Spirit, I just pray that you do your work in us, that we would be changed. Thank you for how you use others in our life to sharpen us, to encourage us, to improve us, to challenge us, to stir us up. Teach us to be open to that, to be humble in receiving that. Teach us to become really good at that, because it's hard to know how to do it sometimes. We, Father, just pray that you would just deepen in us our love for you, but even more this weekend, deepen in us our love for one another, that people would see how we love one another and they would know we are children of God. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Okay, guys, in just a minute, the worship team will come back out and lead us in our closing song. Right now, we want to take a moment to say thank you for your faithful support. Your tithes, offerings, and gifts to Jacob's Well go directly into our One Fund. We're so thankful for all of you who remain committed to giving to Legacy in the year to come. Recently, we got an update from the executive team on all the progress we've made through Legacy. We were able to fully pay off the 2011 North Venue mortgage note because of your commitment. That's pretty cool. The Renewal Series is also brought to you by Legacy, and for more information and the heart behind this, check out the new app or the Legacy Renewal page. For giving today, we invite you to use one of our offering boxes in the Worship Center, the Theater, or the North Venue. If you're on the new app, you can give securely there or on our giving page. You can also mail checks to our address below. Again, thank you so much.
Yeah. just want you, nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you, nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want nothing else, nothing else, nothing else to do. I just want you, nothing else, nothing else, nothing else to do.
Voices lifted up to you is so beautiful. Lord, I pray as we leave this place today that we just leave filled with your Holy Spirit, with your joy. Lord, we just thank you that we get to come together in community with one another to worship you. Lord, we pray all of this in your name. Amen. Well, thank you so much for coming, guys. We hope to see you next weekend.